The cloud. In progress. Okay. Let's go. Sorry for that. Okay, guys, so welcome to the first edition of the Digital Methods for Critical Consumer Studies Summer School. The first edition is 2001. So we are super happy to have all you here, and we are thrilled to work, let's say, and collaborate together. Also because we were very, very impressed from your CV and resume. I mean, and also you should know that we received a lot of application, and I mean, at the end, I mean, we choose you because, I mean, I repeat, we saw that you are very bright PhD students and students in general. So we are happy and honored to have all you here. We, as you can see, we are a lot of people here. We are a bunch of jolly good fellows. And very briefly, I tell you how the teaching team is composed. So we have Guido Anselmi, unfortunately, can't be here today. It will be from tomorrow on. Lucia Banotti from the University of Amsterdam. I don't know if you want to say hello, Lucia, so they can see you.
Yes, hi everyone. Welcome to the school and looking forward to working with you.
Thank you, Lucia. Then we have, of course, myself, then Alessandro Gandini from the University of Milano, that we already saw. Giulia Giorgi, are you with us, Giulia?
Yes, I'm here. Welcome everybody.
Thank you, Giulia. Then we have Domenica La Greca from the University of Pavia,
Good morning to everybody.
Ilir Rama from the University of Milano.
Lir is coming here.
Hello, everyone, for a bit of an exchange.
Okay, so, okay, believe me, Ilir Rama is one of us. And last but not least, Dario Romano, again from the University of Pavia. I don't know if Dario, if you're here, if you want
Good
to say
morning.
just a good morning. Thank you. Thank you, Dario. So, and as you should already know, I mean, we have also an administrative office led by Alessandro Cazzaniga and Olga Introzzi. So if you need for, let's say, technical information, bureaucratic information, administrative information, please refer to Alessandro and Olga. They are super nice and super, super responsive. So what we are going to do today, basically, I mean, I want to explain you the logic of this summer school. So what we want to do with you in these 5 days is to give you an introduction to digital methods. Okay, I mean, we are not so naive to think and to tell you that in just in 5 days, you will master digital methods and you will be, I mean, you will have no problem in using digital methods and apply digital methods in your research. Of course, it's not so easy, but we will do our best to introduce you to the most important and the basic concepts and also technical tool for doing digital methods. So if you hopefully you want to continue this path on doing research with digital methods, I hope you can do in the future. And I mean, I hope we give you the right basis, I mean, to start doing that. So, I mean, I repeat, sometimes the concepts and the technique of digital methods are not super intuitive at first glance, but I mean, don't worry. I mean, it's normal. We are here to help. I tell you a fun fact. I remember 10 years ago, I went to Amsterdam to study with with Richard Rogers, which is the founder of digital methods. And I took a summer school with Richard Rogers, a very intense summer school of two weeks. And I remember, I mean, I was shocked. I didn't understand a single word of what they were saying. So I remember myself crying at the phone with my girlfriend. Oh my God, I'm a stupid asshole. I don't understand anything. But then, I mean, if you have patience, day by day, you will get this. And of course, I mean, in the summer school, I repeat, you for sure will get the basic of the digital methods because we prepared everything to fulfill this goal for you. And the second point, I mean, of the summer school that we would like to address, I mean, if you want, is a very basic one, okay? But truly, truly important from our point of view. So we want to understand which is the relation between digital methods and consumer culture research, also I would say marketing research. Because I mean, we noticed that although digital methods is a well-established methodological paradigm in social science, especially in sociology and sociology of communication, I mean, since 10, 12 years now, we noticed that this paradigm is not so used in consumer culture research and marketing research. So pay attention, I repeat, I mean the digital methods paradigm, which is a very specific paradigm, and we will see better in the next few days. I mean, I'm not meaning research done on digital environment with digital data. Of course, there is this kind of research in consumer culture. Think, for example, to the very, very important, I mean, stream of online ethnography that we have in consumer culture research. But it's not exactly the same thing of digital methods, I mean, you will see. So our question, our starting question, which is the relation, I mean, we can say also, can we study consumer culture using digital methods? I mean, I suppose that, I mean, I'm sure that the answer is yes. And probably I should rephrase better and saying, to what extent, I mean, we can study and understand consumer culture using digital methods, which are the advantages and which are the limits. So where we must stop using digital methods if we want to study consumer culture and then move to other kind of methods, for example, more traditional, like ethnography or interviews or survey, which are the aspects that we can grasp of consumer culture that it's impossible to grasp if we use traditional methods, and so on and so forth. And also I would say, I mean, this problem that digital methods are not so used in consumer culture research and marketing research, I mean, it's not so naive, because if you think attentively and think about digital media, and think about the most prominent digital media we spend most part of our life on, I mean, if you look at, they are all commercial platforms, okay? They are explicitly designed to attract consumer, to stimulate consumer to produce content, to produce interaction. And also they are explicitly designed to track all this interaction and extract value from this consumer interaction. So it's a little bit odd that in consumer culture research and marketing research, these methods are not so used or mainstream, as we can say for sociology. So basically, just to conclude these theoretical introduction, I would say, I mean, we will try to answer this research question in this summer school. So how do digital methods, so intended that, how do digital platforms intended as a complex array of interfaces, devices, algorithms, logics, grammars, and so how do digital platforms shape, influence, constraints, or enable, vice versa, consumer culture processes? And of course, we will use digital methods to try to answer this question. And when I say consumer culture processes, I intend a very, very broad idea, concept. So for example, the everyday digital practices, experiences, opinions, identities, discourses, imaginary that users in their everyday interaction, activity, and social on digital platform develop around brands, product, and or consumer practices. As a matter of fact, our group of research, we can say that me, Alessandro Gandini, Guido, Massimo Roldi, Giulia, Elira, I mean, all Lucia, all the staff I presented you, we are the Italian cluster of digital methods. As you should know, I mean, digital methods is a stream of research born in Amsterdam, so they still have their digital methods initiatives. It is very, very important. But all around the world, we have different schools of digital methods. So, and of course, as you can imagine, in different school and has different point of view approaches on digital methods. And so actually, as a matter of fact, since 5 years now, we started investigating this relationship between social media platform, especially, and consumer culture. I repeat, in this specifically, we will try to understand this phenomenon of platformization of culture, okay? As I described to you before, so how digital platforms shape and constrain and or enable consumer culture. But I mean, we started investigating this topic. I mean, at the time we didn't have this idea of platformization, which actually is quite new in sociological literature, but we started to investigate this topic. For example, Alessandro Gandini and Massimo Eroldi and Davide Beraldo, who unfortunately couldn't be here, but they are part of our Italian cluster of digital methods. They still are doing, I don't know if Alessandro then want to add some few words, but they started, for example, studying YouTube. They started to understand how and to what extent algorithms from one end and crowds of YouTube collaborate in some sense to create musical genre on YouTube. For example, in the same period, me and Adam Arbison, let's say is our mentor. So basically every one of us studied with Adam Arbison. Now he works in Apple, so he's no more part of our cluster of Milano and Pavia, but he was the initiator of this digital methods initiative in Italy at the University of Milano. So we, me and Adam Arbison, for example, we started an understanding, and if you want, I mean, you can have a look to this article, Brand Public, that if you follow brands on social media, especially this person's social media, as Twitter or Instagram, you see that user tend not to organize and engage themselves in the classical format of communities. Okay, sometimes in this person's social media, as Twitter, this format of community, it doesn't exist anymore. And we saw emerging something different, something very much influenced by the structure, by the affordances of Twitter, that we called the brand public. So what is a brand public? Is a digital social formation in which people converge on a user, converge on a branded hashtag, for example, as Louis Vuitton. And this is the only thing that they have in common. They don't interact or discuss like in a classical community. And they simply use the hashtag and the brand, Louis Vuitton, for example, to stage as a platform, to stage private identities or private opinion or emotion. Similarly, with Adam Arbison, we also studied the broad community of One Direction. I mean, this is a work of 2003, 2014. At the time, the community of One Direction on Twitter was a really, really big thing, very, very big. And again, we discovered that, okay, in this way, the fan of One Direction organized themselves in a form of community. So they have very strong and close-knit relation. But I mean, we noticed that they use the hashtag One Direction or related hashtag to One Direction culture and the space of the community, not to talk about the music, not to talk about One Direction or the idols, but they use, I mean, the space to play the game of visibility. So what they do basically is organize themselves to push hashtag One Direction hashtag to the trending topics. Or for example, they spend a lot of time trying to play the game of visibility, so to amass followers and like and retweet from each other. So again, you can see also that here we have a sort of influence of the platforms, of the logic of the platforms in the way, I mean, in which consumer culture is structured. And last but not least, me and Guido published this article, so-called Affordances-Based Brand Relation, an inquiry on emetic brands on Instagram. The article, it will be out soon. I mean, if you want to read it, if you are eager to read it, please drop me an email. I can send you the preprint. But by the way, I suppose in a few days it will be out. I mean, this article is pretty long. I mean, it's complicated to explain now. But again, it's a reflection on how the affordances, so the architecture of Eastern, in this case, influence the brand culture. I mean, more than classical communities or more than the activities of influencers. And we noticed that, I mean, we made a big data analysis. We collected a lot, I mean, almost 1 million of images related to six prominent brands, such as Starbucks, McDonald's, Smirnoff, Louis Vuitton, and Zara. And for all these different brands, if you want, we noticed basically they say the same thing. For the most part, users, when interact, relate with this brand, they do that using a memetic logic, producing a sort of meme-like post. And again, we assume that this is a emerging form of consumer culture that is very much influenced by the affordances of the platform, much more than from the activities or a shared culture of a specific community. What I want to say to you that in this work, of course, especially because it's very quantitative, we focus on this repetitive imaginary, no? So how the platform shape strongly the brand culture, but we discovered, because I mean, we didn't have space, as you can imagine in a single article, what is called replatforming. So where and what extent consumer escape this form of standardization of content production. And this is very interesting. This phenomenon is called replatforming, which is interesting because sometimes, I mean, users tend to diverge very much from what, I mean, the platform tried to constrain them. But at the same time, it's like the platform recognize, I mean, this new pattern of communication and try to subsume again. So replatforming these subversive activities. By the way, I mean, this is just a extemporary reflection I'm doing now, but maybe it's something, I mean, that we can explore also in the summer school. So not simply the platformization of consumer culture, but also the replatformization. So the way in which consumers and users are able to resist this imperative of the standardization of content production. So let's go now to more practical stuff and to the schedule of the school. First and foremost, I mean, I promise I will be brief. So in a few minutes, we will have a keynote lecture from Professor Diego Rinaldo. Diego. Diego is a top scholar in the field of consumer culture. He's a very, very expert scholar in marketing and consumer culture. As a matter of fact, he's a professor of Cage Business School in specifically in marketing and consumer culture. So he will give us a very interesting lecture on digital cultures and the proliferation of identities on social media, which is a very important topic when you want to study consumer culture and digital media. And probably also can be a topic we can explore also taking advantage of digital methods. Of course, Diego will explain better us, but his lecture will be more on focus on theoretical aspect, not methodological, but I repeat, during the school, we can address more practically these kind of topics. The only exception in the schedule is just today. Okay, today, when the lecture of Diego will finish, we'll reconvene at 2 p.m., okay, in the afternoon at the same link, because, I mean, we will introduce you to the project we prepared for the summer school, and we will explain you this project, and also we will explain how we already divided you in different groups. But probably, I mean, Alessandro Gandini will take care of this. Right, Alessandro?
Yes, and with the help of all the other group leaders, I hope.
Yeah, of course, the group leader will do a pitch, but
take care of the session.
If you can manage the thing, I mean, it would be nice, okay? Thank you, Alessandro. These are the five projects we prepared for you. So the first one is called YouTube and the radicalization of consumption. Radicalization, a question mark. So Alessandro will explain you why. The second project is nostalgia and consumption of Facebook. The third project is Alexa and the culture of surveillance on Twitter. The fourth project is Twitter and AstraZeneca. And the last one is consumer brand storytelling on Instagram, Nike and Black Lives Matter. So as you can see, every project has a supervisor, let's say. Okay, so the supervisor is not exactly a person that will work with you hand in hand. I mean, is a person that you can refer, I mean, just to start, for example, planning, design your search plan, your search question, design the main kind of analysis you want to do on the database, and of course, then it's on your own. I suggest you this kind of organization. So every day, early in the afternoon, you convene with your leader and you spend half an hour, maximum 1 hour, to discuss what you can do, the problem and you had, if it's possible to solve this problem, if you need specific analysis on the database, and so on and so forth, and then it's on your own. So I suggest this organization. Just another communication, in project three is supervised by Guido Anselmi, but he won't be here today, so I will take care of this for today's afternoon. So I will introduce this afternoon what is the main goal of this project, Alexa, and the culture of surveillance. And also we already collected for you some data sets to work on. And you will see, we will do a lot of manual work because this is the essence of digital methods. I mean, you must learn first thing first to navigate a data set, a big data set, to understand how a big data set works and what you can do on a data set. Then, of course, you also must use digital tools for data extraction, visualization, and so on and so forth. But that is the second step. I mean, to begin with digital methods, and I think this is the case because I mean, you told me that basically all of you are new to this topic. This is the very basic step. I mean, to understand some basic theoretical concept and start understanding how to navigate manually a data set, okay? Second point, we suggest you, we want that you choose a leader for your group, okay? Of course, the leader is not the boss, nothing of that. I mean, simply the leader has a couple of duties more. So the leader has the duty to coordinate the group work. Very simply say, okay, let's convene at this hour tomorrow and let's do this and this and that. That's it. And as a leader, so I suggest the leader to create a virtual space on her or his own to organize group work, for example, whatever, on Zoom or on Jitsi. And especially the leader is entitled to communicate with us, okay? Because it's easier to communicate in this way only with the leader. Vice versa, if you can imagine if every one of you send us email for asking for suggestions, troubleshooting, and so on and so forth, you can imagine it will become a mess. So vice versa, and if only the leader will communicate with us about issues, it will be easier to communicate with you, especially solve your issues.
Non sul numero perché in camera commercio proprio come siete.
Qualcuno ha il microfono aperto, tipo Alessandra? Ok, sorry.
The liberty to deactivate the microphone.
Alessandro, you're muted now. Calandro.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, for no reason someone muted me, probably because I was super boring. Pardon me, but I promise, almost finished and this lecture will start very soon. So let's share again. Screen. Okay, and then you will see that the schedule for for this week. So today, the day two, we have the first seminar, very theoretical, led by me on digital methods. So I will introduce and explain you finally what is digital methods and which are the main characteristics of this specific paradigm. Then we will have something a little bit more practical. So a seminar on data collection with Selmi. Then the day after, Alessandro Gandini will introduce us to the social network analysis. So a very important technique, as you can imagine, when you do digital methods. Then Ilir and Lucia from 11 a.m. Will do a seminar on digital content analysis. Then in day four, we'll do something more advanced. So I mean, don't worry if you perceive this as a little bit advanced. Don't worry if you can't integrate in your research project this kind of stuff, but it's important that at least you have an idea of this advanced stuff. The first one, very advanced, is cross-platform analysis, but also I guess Julia in her group prepares something related to cross-platform analysis, but we'll see where Julia will explain us. And the very last seminar will be Beatrice Gobbo from Politecnico of Milano, and is a seminar on data visualization. You will see again, data visualization is not super easy at first glance, but she will introduce you to a very, very user-friendly tool that is called RawGraph. And it's very cool, I mean, to visualize and represent digital data. So we do hope that you will use a little bit of RawGraph to visualize your data in your final presentation that we will happen the last day, the 4th of June, from 9:30 on. I mean, you will present your mini project. I would say no more than 10 minutes each. And after that, we will have a nice discussion on all your projects. In the afternoon, I repeat, I mean, it's up to you. Okay, today we will form groups, and then groups are encouraged and free to organize on their own, okay? Again, I mean, the organization of the group work within your own group, it's up to you. Also because I mean, it's the easiest solution. Then we prepare for you some very useful resources, and especially let's see the first one. So this document here. So don't worry, exactly immediately then when I finish talking, I will send you these slides. So you will have all this information and especially all those links, and especially this first one link. So let's see what we prepare for you. Share again. Let me see, it's here. Share screen. Okay, you see in this Google Drive document, we prepare for you virtual, again, welcome package. And you will see, I mean, the logic and the topic and the aims of the summer school. I suppose you already knew. We have, again, all our contacts if you need us. We prepare a day-to-day schedule. So the same thing I prepare for you, but for every day, I mean, we put the link of the Google, of the Zoom room, which is always the same, but it's nice to have the link for every day. Again, I mean, this afternoon we meet at the same link, and I mean, here nothing new, it's simply the week schedule of the lessons. Then you will see the group project, okay? So we have the title, then in afternoon we will populate these members. So we will write the name of all the members of the group. And then if you click here, I mean, I don't do now, you can do later with calm. I mean, if you click here, you can see that we prepared also a research plan for you. So some initial research question to kickstart your group work. And also there is this part. So it's very cool. So resources and tool. Again, during the summer school, I mean, we will introduce you to some of the many tools of digital methods. So we selected the most important ones from our point of view, of course. And you see for each tool, you have a link to reach this tool. And in some cases, we also prepare tutorials for using these kind of tools. So you see we have scraping tools, dataset design tools, visualization tools, visualizes tools. We have a nice tool for studying memes. Probably Julia will tell us more because she's a super expert in this kind of stuff. This is very useful. I mean, if you're not familiar with Excel, please look at this tutorial because it is crucial, I mean, to be able to use at least the basic Excel function to navigate a data set. JFE, I mean, is a very cool software to visualize and analyze networks. So again, we prepare for you some tutorials to follow. And also here we have some little bit advanced information. And so don't worry for this. I mean, these are for those who are familiar or want to do a little bit of coding using Python, but Guido Anselmi will tell you more about this. A template for the presentation, so you can download this template and prepare your presentation. And again, we have all the relevant links. So again, the Zoom link for the lectures. We also prepare a coffee break room. I mean, if you want to convene with your schoolmates in another virtual room, we prepare this Jitsi room for you. And last but not least, this is very important. If you click here, we prepare for you Slack channel. So in which you and all of us, we can do conversation in real time. I mean, for example, for urgent stuff. Of course, you can always find us on the emails, but again, if you need to do some real time conversation, you can use Slack. With this, I really finished. And I thank you for your attention. And now I leave the floor to Diego Rinaldo for the keynote lecture. I'm sorry for this long and boring technical discussion of this school, but I think it was important, I mean, to be on the same page. Thank you so much. Diego, the stage is yours. You can do whatever you want, share stuff. I saw you send me a link for your presentation. Are you okay with that?
Yeah, let me try.
Or you need that I do something for you?
Do you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay.
But it's blank, it's black.
Now can you see my PowerPoint?
No.
Let me try again. Is now better?
It's better, but it's still black.
Sorry, anyway. I don't know what to do because now it looks... So maybe could you please open the file I sent you and share with me?
Yes. And you tell me when
I'm, you know, from my screen should be sharing to yours. So
yeah.
I will stop my sharing.
Download.
Well, thank you, Alessandro, for taking care of these. So let me start by saying two words about who I am. I'm Italian, as you can see from my accent, specifically Sicilian, but I spent most of my working life in Milan, where I attended university, then a PhD, and for a few years I was there assistant professor of marketing until I received a nice offer at the Kedge Business School, which is a French business school, multi-campus. I was in the campus, I decided to go into campus of Marseille. And even though increasingly in the last few years my work has become interdisciplinary, I thank you very much, Alessandro for the very nice presentation and introduction to my work. But I would say that the consumer culture theory has been my intellectual home, but very often I started from this home and I explored different topics, and I don't want to list all of them. But if I have to find a fil rouge, I've been very interested on how the market and consumption sometimes, but not necessarily, play a role in the construction of identities. And, you know, I've worked on fashion, on gender, on sexuality, and on a lot of other things. And this has been a fil rouge, linking very various aspects. Very early, I think I was just out on my PhD, I wrote a book chapter on the metrosexual. I think that you might not remember that. Now you would rather call them hipsters or with other names. But that was the first time I examined market-mediated or market-constructed identities. And it was an identity that didn't really, it was really created from the marketing world and didn't achieve any kind of impact beyond the media hype about that, because there were consumers who didn't, mostly didn't identify with these labels. And increasingly, I'm also studying the intersection between religion, spirituality, esotericism, and consumer culture. And I see that social media have been changing a lot, have been really changing our digital cultures, if you want, and really changed the way these new identities or emerging identities, which were secret, occult, hidden, diffuse, and are made cool by consumer culture, so that identity value is created. Many more people are willing to identify with these cultural and socially constituted words. So I will drive you. My presentation on True will be not methodological at all, will be sort of theoretical, but I'll try to translate all these complex notions in very simple terms, because I know that many of you, but maybe not everybody, are sociologists. So to me, you know, consumer culture, as I will explain, is a sort of a bastard discipline. So it's applied sociology, but it's also applied anthropology, but it's also applied psychology, applied cultural studies, applied whatever. So sometimes it's we have a very mixed way of theorizing that goes across all these disciplines. But I will explain that in a minute. Alessandro, do you have any new?
I'm ready. So okay. Let me share the screen.
Thank you very much.
And so, I mean, just tell me when I have to switch the slides.
Perfect. Oh, you can leave on the first slide. Oh, you can go on the second slide, please. And let me also say that from a methodological point of view, I want to share my methodological outlook. You know, CCT goes with interpretive and critical methods. So I think that most of the time I apply the methods that are interpretive and critical. However, like many people in consumer culture theory, for most of the time, I carry out studies with 20 to 30 informants by interviewing them. I've done extensive ethnographies. Like in some of my fields, you know, I have ongoing ethnographies for 10 years and more. So I am in a moment where I have these complex introspective reflexive issues, because I am a part of communities I study. But by being a scholar, my subjectivity is shaped by that as well. So I have a complex insider-outsider issues every time I write the methodological section of my papers. And I wouldn't say that I started studying consumer digital culture, but in many of my empirical settings and in my life as well, digital culture happened. So I really saw, and I will make it towards the end, an ongoing study that I have on people who today identify as witches. Really, digital cultures, digital platforms have totally change the way and the possibility for people today to call themselves witches. There are many people today say, I am a witch. Tappenson will give you a little bit towards the end of the genealogy, but this is the same for any other kind of possible market mediated identity. So I'm will talking about witches, but it's a much general process of identification, and consumer culture has a lot to play with that. Not everything, but it's a lot. Sometimes it's religion, sometimes it's politics, sometimes it's other things, but the consumer culture and the social media have totally changed that. Alessandro introduced before the concept of affordances, which is, I will use a very simple definition, and probably this week we will go back to that by people more qualified than me, but affordances is what a platform allows you to do. So the point I'm making is that beyond all the other things that that platforms allow you to do, they also interact with this process of identity formation and interaction with other people, because these identities are reclaimed individually, but they are socially constituted, and the social media is an important part of that. So I will start my presentation by introducing what is consumer culture and what is consumer culture theory. There are so many definitions, and for consumer culture theory, or CCT as we like to call it, I will provide a few readings towards the end. I cannot really synthesize in this limited time, like 40 years of research, but if you are interested into that, I want to have readings. And the key notion is that consumption is a key site for identity construction, I could say co-construction by individuals. And I can also say that the process, and this is mainstream consumer culture, is not particularly me saying that. I think that this is one of the building blocks already 30 years ago, that consumption is a key site where people co-create their identities using market-produced symbols and other resources. And the key point that is not so evident in literature, so it's my original contribution for this presentation, and something that I've been reflecting upon a lot, but this is the very first time I'm sharing online or in a conference, so this is a little piece that is new and mine, is that this process has created, I wasn't sure about the word to use. Eventually I settled down with a proliferation, but I could have used a fragmentation, I could have used a specialization. And bear with me, this is not theoretically as precise as I would like to, but bear with me and it will be much more clear as I continue. And Alessandro, would you please turn the page? So I will start, and again, there are millions of definitions of consumer culture. There are, again, some nuances, whether you are dealing with consumer culture or consumer society. Sometimes, the nuance is different. Alessandro, I think that the screen is off now. Yeah, me neither. I can't see slides anymore. I don't even see Alessandro online.
I think we lost Alessandro for a moment. So
Alessandro is disconnected. So Alessandro, I mean Alessandro Gandini, would you maybe share
my
slide for me?
Can you send the link again, please?
Yeah, yes.
I cannot find it in my...
I thought
to load it up here in the chat with me or whatever.
So I think I know I sent to somebody else. So anybody, I will send in the generic chat just in case.
Yes, I was about to ask, maybe it's probably helpful so people can...
No, anybody can have it, so download it. Oh, Alessandro, we had lost you.
Yeah, sorry. It's a problem of connection. So shall we restart again?
Yes, please. Yes.
Sorry,
please.
Sorry, Diego.
But in case for everybody as a backup plan, please use the link and share, you know, use it so in case something happens again. So I was saying that there are many definitions. I will use this as a very simple one. It is, and again, I use culture here because it's a consumer culture theory, but most of you are sociologists, so I could have used, and sometimes I do, consumer society, and you know, if you substitute the culture with society, it works quite enough. So it's a cultural society where a majority of consumers desire goods and services and expediences or market offers more in general that are valued for non-utilitarian reasons. So I put desire at the center of consumer culture, and you could say that marketing or branding are technologies to stimulate this desire. And you do not need a majority of the population to be able to afford this kind of products. So think to the very luxury products. So think of a Ferrari. Not many people can afford a Ferrari or a haute couture fashion item, but they can desire it. So the whole point of consumer culture is that the marketing, maybe through market segmentation, you know, they produce a lot of advertising symbol and desire for these products that only a few people can afford, and the desire is much spreader. So it's a much global phenomenon that has a lot of consequences. Some say it's materialism, the diffusion of materialism, materialist values. Some they would say it's overconsumption. There are many definitions of materialism, but it's like the idea that we can be happy through consumption. And it's, you know, I am a sort of Buddhist into that. It's fake, because the moment we have something, we want something else. And again, it's a cycle that the self perpetuates. So consumer society or consumer culture, it's an historical process. There are some countries where it happened before, like luxury items already existed, but in France, during the time of the French Revolution, it wasn't a must think. You really need the advent or a big enough middle class to have access, to have money, to have access to this kind of products that are not required to eat, to satisfy the very utilitarian reasons. So when you say that you need these because you are cool, or when advertisers suggest that the reason to buy a smartphone is to be cool, or a Rolex, you know, to show off your status and so on and so forth, this is non-utilitarian, this is symbolic. In marketing or in business strategy, when dealing with the basic strategies available to companies or to brands to make money, or as they like to say, to have a sustained competitive advantage over competitors, there are basically two strategies. Then there are some hybrids, but The polarization is between a cost leadership, Ryanair, you produce a commodity at the lowest possible price on the market, or differentiation. Differentiation, you create a market offer that is better than the competition at a higher price so that you can have extra profits. Even cost leadership is profitable. I mean, it's two different strategies, but there can be only one cost leader in the market because the lowest is objective, the lowest price is the lowest price. Whereas every brand, every company can differentiate on a different point of view. You can be better from many points of view. And very often what you say that differentiation comes in two varieties. One is functional differentiation. A car can be faster than another, or it can consume less energy, oil, whatever, than another, or it can be more environmentally friendly, and you can measure. This is a sort of objective features. And again, you can be better than other, you can quantify that, you can have a consumer reports saying which brand has the best environmental performances or whatever. So what happens, it's often through a technological breakthrough that sometimes for a short duration, a company is better than other, than others. And this is the best way to differentiate your product because you have an objective, allow me to use this term, quality. And the other way is symbolic differentiation. So symbolic differentiation is basically using advertising, social media promotion, and celebrity relations, influencers, to say, and when I teach marketing students, it's hard to tell to them to take this message. So basically, you are using marketing magic to convince consumer that the product which is exactly like any other is different from a symbolic point of view. So you use a kind of marketing technology to transfer meaning to products that are very similar, and any actual differentiation is superficial and cosmetic rather than real thing. So you can say that this is shampoo for women, you do a pink packaging, and you sell it at a higher price. So sometimes this is a symbolic differentiation. There are more complex examples. So back to consumer culture. So I'm already introduced why marketing is at the core of this. Is it stimulates desires for market offers that are valued for symbolic reasons. So symbolic reasons very often are not based on some objective qualities. And a majority of consumers want these products, buy this product and use, display, put these products and services and market offers at the center of their lifestyles to make a statement, to show off, to create a relationship with other people, to have a social esteem, to live a good life, and so on and so forth. So this is a working definition of a consumer culture. And it's very problematic. So marketing very often is not critical of these things. And when they are, they talk of what they call unintended consequences of marketing. Whereas, from the point of view, it's unintended, but it's what happens. So you can imagine the amount of frustration and unhappiness that is created by these. And again, critics of consumer culture are those who say that our societies are becoming increasingly materialistic because of this. Another point is that it stimulates overconsumption. Think of smartphones, it's still usable, but you want the next one. Think of fast fashion. I mean, you buy these, you wear it 2-3 times, and then you want the next thing. So the weight of the nature, environment, resources are unbearable. Or it's a social justice, and we'll see more of that later on. This mechanism is at the core of a social and cultural construction of processes that just reproduce the status quo and reproduce the situation of inequalities of many people, including working class people or the poor or black people or LGBTQ, etc., people or women or indigenous people and so on and so forth. So I'm just scratching the surface, but this is again our working definition of consumer culture and everything that goes with it. Next, please. Thank you very much. So consumer culture theory, or CCT is still a minority perspective in consumer research, but very influential. Consumer culture theory in a sort of division of labor between other parts of the consumer research discipline, they initially focus on new things that eventually are taken on by other parts of the disciplines. And there have been a lot of leakages to the discipline of marketing and, to the profession of marketing and consumer research. So let me tell you more a little bit. Next. So I'm simplifying, but consumer research, if we have to simplify, is made of two souls, two different and not so related academic communities. There are the psychologists and everybody else. So everybody else, it was like sociology, you know, in the 80s, it was just very few people, a core of people, were like a couple of anthropologists, sociologists or two, and you know, feminist scholars, a little bit of people coming from cultural studies, which were sort of discriminated because in consumer psychology, you do experiments. Experiments, it's what you do, and you know, experiments from an epistemological point of view are very strong as a methodology because you can establish causation. So you can really say that by manipulating stimuli, that X causes Y. So, you know, not even with the multiple regressions and other kind of methods, you can do something less. So they, you know, they claimed, you know, their approach was scientific, and you interviewed 20 consumers and you find that these, you think this is research, this is science, how can you generalize? So these people were marginalized at the beginning, but they found back, and for the first 20 years, they came with a lot of different names to call themselves, which was not an easy thing to do, because somebody talks about a naturalistic inquiry, somebody else talk of sociological aspects of consumption, somebody else talk about meaning or sacred and profane in consumer research. I mean, there was a lot of proliferation of labels to call the others who were not doing consumer psychology. And eventually, I think now it's almost 30 years ago, two scholars, Eric Arnold and a few others, I think I don't want to prioritize one or the other, I will give you literature at the end. They came up with this notion of consumer culture theory, and they frame it as an academic brand. Academic brand, you know, only people in marketing would do that. So it's a label, a unifying label to federate people. So at least for political or academic politics reasons. So by having this common name, it was easy for people to identify themselves. I am a CCT person. So there were marketing departments started to hire at least one CCT person. PhD student could claim this identity. You know, my PhD thesis is in CCT, and conferences, workshop, methodological workshop, and so on and so forth. So this is how these parts of the discipline came to be. And if we can go to the next slide. So consumer research, when you are in a marketing department, has this strange in-between status, because we are often told in that context that consumer research is the theory upon which any sound of marketing, branding, advertising, whatever, strategy, pricing, distribution, you name it, strategy should be based on. So it's the theory, whereas marketing is the practice. Whereas consumer research is applied research and has many, many disciplines that can help us understand better consumption. But I would say that consumer psychology is a straightforward, is applied psychology. Psychology, social psychologists or cognitive psychologists who study consumption. Whereas consumer culture theory is very mixed, because you know the story now, it goes from the beginning. You had people from different disciplines, and the consumer culture theory, you know, if you are socialized into that arena, you need to study a little bit of sociology, a little bit of anthropology, because they gave the concepts and methods that are the currency, you know, the exchange currency to claim a status for yourself and to understand things. So there are very few theories that are indigenous to CCT. Most of them are borrowed from somewhere else and applied. And during different periods in these, you know, now it's decades long intellectual history, there have been sort of academic fashions in the disciplines that have been applied. I will now make you some examples, which is also a way into understanding what the discipline is about. If you can go to the next slide. Okay, now, I think I covered about that. So another thing I want to say is that in consumption, since many people, including myself, didn't like to study what people do in supermarkets, we call people consumers, but people are individuals. So it's very difficult to study any human activity that doesn't have a consumption side into that. So you might disagree with that, but in this discipline, there has been a sort of a colonization of environment, of aspects. And so you can study sexuality, you can study race, you can study indigenous post-colonial stuff, you can study like I do spirituality, or religion or esotericism. And to do the trick and to publish in marketing or a consumer research journal, you just call people consumers, the same people you could call citizens or individuals in other contexts, okay? And this is one of the ways many people in this field have really broadened the scope of consumer research to areas that 40 years ago wouldn't be called consumption. So to make the example, remember it's applied something else. So meaning is a central category in anthropology and other disciplines. So in consumer research, in consumer culture theory, you study brand meaning. So brand is a central marketing notion. Before, there were a lot of notions, brand identity, brand personality, brand, a lot of, you know, you name it. I mean, again, there's a proliferation of brand-related notions. And people in consumer culture theory started to apply interpretive methods and anthropological conceptualization to study how brand provide meaning to people. And I don't want to go into details about that, but one of the key idea in the past, particularly the professional marketing, people working in Coca-Cola or McDonald's or Louis Vuitton or whatever, the big brands, they were really thinking of a brand identity. This was the notion. And they were considered themselves as the key through their activities, the key creators of brand meaning or brand identity. You know, we use advertising to transfer this meaning. So our brand Chanel is about relaxed elegance or luxury or refined taste or sexiness or you name it, virility, being a good mom, living the good life. So they were saying that it's all about them. Yes, advertising agency, but the market system. Here, the totally different point of view was that consumers were co-creators of brand meaning and the most important ones. So it was about the centering, the importance of marketing technologies and tools, and asking, but what do consumers actually do with these symbols? And they realized that if you were lucky, consumers would amplify the official meanings of the brand, but you were very lucky and that didn't happen over time. Often, most of the time, a consumer would create different meanings that sometimes were good for the brand, and with good market research, you could understand them, amplify them, and using back in advertising. But sometimes a consumer were resisting the brand meanings, the official brand meaning, and circulating opposite, countervailing brand meanings. And often people in brands have no idea about that, because people in brands, like anybody else, they live in their bubble. They are self-referential, and with you know, basic market research that was not interpretive or critical, they had no idea. So can I go to the next slide? One very interesting paper talked about what they called, and sometimes it's funny names for concepts, what they called the doppelganger brand image, which is basically the fact that thanks to the culture producing role of consumers and intellectual activists, NGOs, artists, and many others, in the market often, you know, the most iconic brands create an evil twin, that is the meaning of doppelganger from German Romanticism, create a dark image. So the more you communicate that you are socially responsible, have fun with us, etc., the more in the market, through consumption and against the will of the brand or the marketers, these oppositional images circulate. And this is, you know, very different ways of looking. So the idea is that consumers are co-creators of market and brand and consumption-related culture, and they do things with the symbols created by marketers. This is very, very evident. I mean, you know, this is the mascot of McDonald's. It's a clown, and it's the dark, evil version of that, with the horror movies influences about that. So sometimes you do things to the actual logo. You create mock advertising, but it's much more than that. You circulate symbols that are much more important than what the companies can do with their own means, okay? So I'll go to the next slide. As another example, experience. Experience comes from consumer culture theory. Now it's, you know, like everybody in professional marketing talks about that. We have classes in business school about experiential marketing and so on and so forth. We now have people in design, and again, in digital is, you know, the digital experience, how we design that, et cetera. But it comes from philosophy, you know, Merleau-Ponty, et cetera. And again, so the idea is that you take something from another discipline, experience as a philosophical category, and you use it to study something that is important from the point of view of consumption or marketing, like client experience, customer experience, consumer experience. Next. Communities, you know, community, important notion in sociology. So very soon it was evident, I think these are two important takeaways, that consumers co-create brand meaning and the meaning of consumption. And the other things is that through consumption, and sometimes through, again, market-related symbols, experiences, offers, shops, possibility to meet special events, people form communities. So this was, again, there was a proliferation of notions about that, but this is very simple to make the point. You use a notion from sociology of community, and you try to understand how some brands like Harley-Davidson, maybe Apple or Macintosh, maybe others, are able to shape the social, not only the identification process, the identities, but also the socialization of people that we call consumers in marketing. So this has been conceptualized in different ways. I put it on brand communities, but again, other people use a notion back in the history of consumer culture theory, subcultures of consumption. So they use the notion of a subculture from cultural studies, Dee Cadbidge and the other people, and they say they added consumption. And again, it's other people, Bernard Couvat, who's a colleague of mine at Cage Business School, he used this French sociologist Michel Maffesoli, who had talked of postmodern tribes, and he created this notion of consumer tribes. And it's happening again. I know that in the reading list, you had this notion, these couple of papers about liquid consumption. And again, you take liquidity from Bauman and you use it to study specifically consumption. So the paper are super abstract, but sometimes it's, you know, sometimes it's sort of hilarious how people are desperate to find the next cool notion from high theory to apply them to study brand consumption or experiences or whatever. But it is in the DNA of the discipline, okay? So let's go to the next slide. And of course, I could have mentioned brand public, but I will not do that. So not only it has been really putting a lot of intellectual stuff into the discipline of consumer research, coming from these higher theories, but also methodological tools of all kind, coming from anthropology, coming from ethnographies, phenomenological interviews, participant observation, critical studies, historical studies, semiotic analysis, you name it. There has been a lot of work in having alternative methods respect to the mainstream, which in consumer research was experiments. In marketing, you had this sort of theoretical, empirical generalizations, thanks to quantitative and multivariate methods, but that was it. And now you could do ethnographies, you could do phenomenological interviews with 20 consumers, even less sometimes, to talk about brand relationship and so on and so forth. It was really discovery oriented, particularly in the bad stage. And I would say that now with the digital, studies, and maybe it will emerge, there have been also borrowing methods from other disciplines. Alessandro, the two Alessandro here have been very important in doing these, because for most of the time, everybody who wanted to study digital stuff could do that by using a method championed by Robert Kozinets, which is called Netnography. That is the way in CCT we talked a lot of digital ethnography, basically. And again, there can be nuances and differentiation, but let me simplify in saying that it's the name we use for digital ethnographic approaches. And what I found increasingly dissatisfying with that is that typically we are not trained into other kind of methods. I think, let me make an example of myself. I'm sort of good at doing a qualitative analysis of social media content, but it's so time consuming and I'm very frustrated that I'm not able to apply all the methods that this week is going to be about. And maybe it wasn't very clear, but you know, even before being asked to sharing with you my theoretical notes this morning, I'd asked Alessandro if I could attend this week, so I would be a student like you as soon as I finish this presentation.
Oh, so of course you can. Be my guest, be our guest.
I will switch roles because this is how useful this incredible week. You know, I couldn't believe my eyes when I saw the call for paper because I think that this is much needed. And we can go to the next slide. So I will now deal with a notion that is in sociology, I guess you know very well the debate between agency and structure. You know, are people free to define themselves even in these liquid times, or how does social structures like social class, ethnicity, gender, sexuality, and blah, 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 you name it, constrain behavior? And you can use Giddens, Bourdault, or any other theories to find the middle ground between these two aspects. I would say that in the first generation of consumer culture, the tension was put on the agency side of that. So you know, this was a part where postmodernism was an important, whatever it is, postmodernism, poststructuralism, etc. They said with the collapse of grand narratives, people were increasingly free to be whoever, whatever they wanted to be. And the first generation of consumer research really highlighted the consumer agency and the emancipating role of consumer culture. And this is how I link this to identity. You know, consumers could really be whatever they wanted to be, and the market and consumption will provide ways for them, symbols, objects, practice, possibilities to interact with other people to form more or less transient forms of communities to acquire new identities and to be really what they wanted to be. However, I would say that in the last few years, so I think that the methodological approaches that we use at the time, really interviews with 20 consumers, which are great. You can learn a lot if they are well selected and you have a good theoretical ideas and research question behind that. But I think that it was a byproduct of this methodological approach. We have a bias and we as people, and even more so as consumers, we like to believe that we are the protagonist of our lives, and we are sort of unaware of how culture, society, and our privileges or inequalities that are embedded, embodied in our subjectivity influence our horizon. So I think that in recent years, the shift has come to these structural conditions that shape. So this is why there's a need for methods that go beyond asking consumers what they think about these, or trying to enter into their the way they give meanings to things, the way they see the world. So I think that now it has, we moved beyond that and we look at the iron cages. Maybe they are golden cages because consumption can make things very cool, but we try to look at that. So here you have people talking about race, intersectionality, gender, and so on and so forth. And it has been very sophisticated, really. The level of theoretical sophistication has increased a lot. But I would say that one of the big debates from the beginning that under new names is still there, it's agency and structure. And intersectionality is another important influence in the way people in consumer culture theory now look at the consumption marketing phenomena. Let's go to the next slide, please. So one of the key idea, the key takeaway of my presentation is that consumption today under capitalist, neoliberal, postmodern, you name it, late modern if you want, whatever, societies or culture, has become a key site for identity construction, for identity formation. So the key idea, and I will make examples later on, is that true consumption, not necessarily true brands, but true consumption, individuals deploy range, they use and make their own, but resources that are provided by marketers, by the market under capitalistic societies, and they combine them with other resources that are not marketing, market created, but they have this creating role in constructing their own personal and collective identities. So some of the first papers really looked at the reasons why this would happen, but let me make some examples. So an ethnography of the bikers, of Harley-Davidson bikers, which is another of the iconic classical paper in consumer culture theory, was really looking at this phenomenon. But the reality is that very often brands cannot really mediate this kind of identity building processes. So they can provide a teeny tiny part of the resources. So it's very rare for people to identify with a brand and put a brand at the core of their identity. And I would say luckily so, because I wouldn't put any brand at the core of my identity, even though now with platforms, socializations, maybe not identity, but you know, socialization is part of identity building process. It's mediated, you know, what happens if you lose your Facebook, social media, whatever platform you are on, TikTok, even if you are way younger than me, et cetera, you lose access to your friends, way to be part of the culture. So it's a big, big things that have exploded with digital culture. Let's go to the next slide. It's the same content on purpose. So the interesting thing is that some of these sites, consumption, some of these way of consuming, they put themselves in ideological opposition with capitalism and with the big brands. So you have sites where identities are created and collection from the hippies of the 1960s and 70s to their today's manifestation about that. And they are against the mainstream. They are against, they are really subculture and sometimes countercultures. But still, as soon as you study them from a consumer culture theory perspective, you start to see new ways of new market approaches. So of course they wouldn't wear Dolce & Gabbana if you are in a context like this, but you have maybe small artisanal kind of stuff. You have these subcultural entrepreneurs, and the market that is chased outside of the main door comes back from the window. I'm literally translating an Italian idiom about that. And it's incredible. If you look at the very countercultural communities, 20 years later, you have again market forms that are maybe contrasting with the mainstream markets, but often not that much. So let's go to the next slide. And again, if you look to metrosexual or hipsters in France, you call them bobo, bohemian, bourgeois, etc. Sometimes there's not really contraposition with prevailing market ideologies. But again, you know, you use brands, consumption, and all kind of products, practices, and meanings that are market created to create sometimes a stable sense of identity and socialization processes, and so on and so forth. And next. So why consumption has become a key site for these identity construction building processes? Why consumer use resources provided by the market to build their identity? There are many different theoretical explanations that have been provided to offer that. So this is the iron cage again, which is a notion that in sociology you know very well. And people find it increasingly difficult to construct their identity in the sites, let me use this strange term, which usually provided identity to people. Think of nation states. Okay, there is a new nationalism, but they are not as powerful as in the 18th century, etc., 19th century, etc. With globalization immigrated, and now people, yeah, I'm French, I'm Italian, but it's not as in other historical periods. Religion. Now people are like, they go to church for weddings. Many say we are spiritual, but not religious. And it's really mix and match spirituality. And of course, consumption is a big part with the decline in religious authority. So political identities, politics in the same of political parties, you know, there's been a collapse. You see in many countries how the political debate, you do not trust the state, you do not trust the politician. It happens, but it's difficult to really put your heart. You know, people who 30 years ago would say, I'm a communist, I am this, I'm that, and now they vote maybe, but still vote, but it's difficult to put that. The work, jobs. Now, yeah, there are still people who take pride in saying, I am a PhD student, I am a lawyer, I am a professor, I am whatever. But with you do that with the good jobs. You how pride you can put in saying, I am a Starbucks barista? How pride can you make in making, you know, any kind of, you know, of building your identity into any kind of a precarious job that you might have? And it's so common that you do not build your career from, you know, 18 years old to until you retire in the same company. You can switch organization, you can switch jobs. So I think that this is why building identity with consumption, you know, jobs that are so frustrating and identity that do not maintain the promise that they had in the past. So consumption, and again, with marketing to make it cool and sexy, etc., has become a place where people live these incredible experiences. Can I go to the next slide, please? Live these incredible experiences, you know, can be sport. People are more excited than their football team, than their political party or religion or whatsoever. And again, some people talk about these things as, you know, the new religions of the future, or, you know, fanaticism and so on and so forth. And there's been a lot of work in this arena, sacred, profane, sacralization of consumption, and so on and so forth. And there has been one interesting paper whose title was Working Weeks, Rave Weekends, that was really using the postmodern metaphor of the fragmentation of identity. And they interview 20 consumers or whatever it was, I can't remember the number of informants, but they really mapped how many people would live a frustrating working weeks with jobs that were not fulfilling them, then would, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, that gave meaning to their lives. And their friends from whatever subcultural activities they were engaging with were much more important than most family members. Again, family, one of the old things we would put identity with, and their work colleagues. So again, identity processes which are individually enacted, but socially constructed. Next. So, and at one point, and until now, it's mainstream consumer culture theory, but one of the points I want to make is this proliferation of identities, or fragmentation, or specialization, if you want. And consumer culture has been still ongoing process at the core of this process of proliferation, because consumption provide a lot of different ways for people to identify with. And again, they can be combined, they can be created, it's really multiple, and it's the promise that you can find who you really are and people who vibe at the same vibration as yours through consumption, and the market provides that, you know, can be whatever, can be really whatever. And of course, there are some of these new or emerging identities, think of LGBTQIA, think of people on the autistic spectrum, think of a lot of other of these identities that reflect, so invisible identities of the past and now are becoming more visible. It's not like they are really indigenous of consumer culture, but consumer culture is part of the process of making them more visible, sexy, and so on and so forth, as I will explain in a minute. So some emerge outside of consumer culture, but it's very difficult to disentangle them these ways from consumer culture. The market enters, and now people who were pilgrims in the past are becoming tourists and increasingly consumers. So it's really the logic of the market. However, there are some identities that really originate in consumer culture. And sometimes it's difficult to separate the two because they really entwine. So consumers are really key actors in the process of creating and proliferating new specialized, increasingly fragmented identities, because they co-create the meanings, sometimes the object in a physical sense, and the doings, which is a way in consumer culture theory we often use these three words: meanings, objects, and doing. Doings is like practices, which I guess you know it's a very loaded word, practice theories in the plural. But again, consumers, sometimes long before marketers like big brands realize that there are market opportunities, are important creators of the meanings, the objects, and the doings associated to those new identities. So they contribute to expand and make accessible these new identities. So they broaden their identity value, the possibility for a larger and larger number of people to identify with these identities. Sorry for keeping using identities, but it's the way it is. And social media have been instrumental in accelerating this process, because through internet before and social media, people have access to information and other people that they wouldn't otherwise. So even the most stigmatized and difficult to assert in real life identities, you'll find somebody like you. Maybe it's on the other part of the world. Maybe you, it's in your city, but you wouldn't I mean, there's a lot of privacy, or there used to be, going on, etc. So you can be anonymous, and then you meet other people, you meet in real life, you create, etc. You teach other people how to build the objects that are required for this identity. You teach them subcultural skills. You share the meanings that are created, and you have a brand new identity. So social media is an important part of that. And I will now make quite a few examples. Next. So proliferation. Okay, this is, we can go next. Proliferation, a lot. So again, the decline of the authority of nation state with immigration, with people, with a lot of stuff. You know, the being French is okay, but it's not a doom, a destiny. You can decide, even if you live in France, how French you can be, and then you have immigration, second generation. It's complex issues. And again, this is a shift towards consumption as a site for identity construction. Next. So in the past, you wouldn't choose your religion, like you wouldn't choose your social class. You were born into that. You didn't choose your nationality. You couldn't be a global nomad, etc. But now with you can choose your religion, and you can choose your to detach from official religious organization, and you can mix and match a little bit of Buddhist meditation on this weekend at a retreat, a little bit of shamanic ayahuasca, etc., and a little bit of tourism to South America or whatever to meet real shamans, etc. And you are a very spiritual person, but you do not identify with any specific religion. And again, there's a lot of market-related and consumption phenomena into that. Next. I need to talk about identity politics. So identity politics doesn't start with consumption, but in the last 50 years, first it was the women's movement, four waves of feminism, if you allow me to use this notion, etc. So again, you wouldn't identify necessarily as a woman or as a feminist, but now you start to identify as a woman in complex new ways. The same with people. Next, the same with racism. And again, and also the Black Panther, these in the States, but again, all kind of, and again, suddenly being black or being lesbian, again, with the gay, next slide. Being gay, being black, being lesbian, being a woman, being and working class woman, and so on and so forth. Being a lesbian woman as opposed to be a black man, you know, this is part of the process of proliferation of identity, or at least the greater salience of specific aspects, specific facets of your identity. So identity building process are so much intertwined with identity politics these days, and it didn't start with consumption, but now it has entered the consumption. Next. So globalization in the many ways we can intend, the globalization of people with immigration, tourism, you know, flows of people, flows of ideas, flows of products, flows of technologies, flows of media, etc. has been part of that. So it's really instrumental, because how could you identify as a Buddhist if you were born in a city where everybody else is Christian and you never met any other Buddhist and you never heard about Buddhism as a possible religion for you? How could you practice meditation if it is not available? But even if it's not available, by traveling, and next, by social media and so on and so forth, you can access that. So a notion from the political world that is intersectionality, which is the idea that, let me go to the next slide. I hope all of you have heard this message, this notion. It was coined by Black feminists, saying that their identity was at the intersection of being Black and being women. So in feminism, so in political feminism, all the analysis of oppression of women didn't take into consideration the fact that Black women live different challenges from white women. White women are still white, so they enjoy a lot of privilege that Black women do not enjoy. So you need to take into consideration to analyze oppression and also to design ways, solutions to fairer society. You need to take into consideration that not all women are the same. Some are, for example, the object of double discrimination, and you can easily study that. And social class, rich, upper class Black women like Oprah are not really the same of very poor underclass Black women. And you can get crazy in mapping all the different kind of intersection, this distribution of privilege and disadvantage, lack of privilege, stigma, discrimination in your life. And these, I think that this, the idea of a social construction of gender and intersectionality, the idea that identity is multifaceted like this, and you need to go beyond the idea that all women are the same, all Black people are the same, and look at different specific configuration. It's the most intellectually exciting because it allows you to look at even your situated subjectivity, let alone what happens in the world today. Black Lives Matter, for example, which is one of the five projects that we are going to take care of this week, is really incredible. But this has contributed to this proliferation of identity. In the past, I'm Black, Black power. No, now I'm a Black woman, which is different. Or now I'm a Black trans woman. Or now I'm a Black trans woman with handicap. Social media has become instrumental to give visibility of these increasingly specialized identities that have been created and made available to other people. And again, this doesn't originate in consumer culture on the market, but as soon as you create a new identity, you have a market segment, you have a market niche. Sometimes for subculture entrepreneurs who are part of that identity and they feel neglected by the market, so they teach other people, they create objects, they put something, you know, they can do for free. Sometimes they can do as a business for that. It happens all the time. Again, proliferation of identity. I'll go to the next slide. And again, now social media in politics as in consumer culture has been so really has been an important part of that. So now in feminism, we say that we are in a fourth way of feminism that has been enabled by social media. But what the feminist has said upfront with this notion of social media enabled feminist battles, it's the same for any other political identity politics battle. It's for Black Lives Matter. They've been around for ages, but it's hashtag Black Lives Matter, like it was hashtag Me Too. And again, it's a proliferation. Intersectionality has been really important in all these form of activism and increasingly consumer activism. Let's go next. Black trans lives matter. Let's go next. Black trans, queer, lesbian, gay, bisexual, disabled, whatever, and you could add like 50 other ways, matters. You see this fragmentation, this specialization, this proliferation, which has important social political consequences. Let's go to the next slide. Platforms have been so important because They give visibility to these increasingly specialized identities, and they provide the tools for people to fight together. Okay, it was already there with the internet, but again, there was the digital divide. You needed to have access to computers. You needed to be able to speak English more often than not at the very beginning. And now with the social media, it has accelerated because so many, next slide, please. All you need is a smartphone, which is many more people, even in developing countries, have access. And then each social media platforms has its own affordances and interact in these broader processes. Let's go to the next slide. And again, the fourth way is of feminism. And again, this is very politically correct because you have women of different races and ethnicities and so on and so forth. And next. And again, I covered that. Next. And again, you know, this proliferation of identities is maybe more evident than anything that is related to sexuality than in any other field. So for even when I grew up, you didn't have all these identities. You know, most people were happy with men, women, or male, female, and gay or lesbian, and straight, heterosexual. I mean, these were 2x2 metrics. I mean, then still you would have trans people, but they were not so considered in the mainstream discourse, despite the fact that the trans women were at the beginning of the gay liberation, so-called gay liberation movement, but you know, the gay was the umbrella term. Then you started having LG, lesbian first, because they're women. So again, gay men are still men, so they have a lot of privilege, intersectional analysis. So let's put the women first. Then bisexual, the poor bisexual, they were discriminated by straight people because they were too gay. So they were not mainstream. And then by gay themselves, it's just a stage, it's just a phase. In 10 years, you'll be fully gay, fully lesbian, etc. Transgender people, again, they were, you know, the struggle and the oppression that you can feel as a gay man or a lesbian woman are nothing to the incredible amount of oppression that you and difficulties, state-created, market-created, socially created, culturally created, if you are a trans person. But this was just so. For many years, people were just happy from gay to LGBT. Then you added the queer as a sort of umbrella term. And then you started adding a lot of increasingly more specialized identities that were invisible under LGBTQ. And, you know, every year the letters are increasing. Even I, sometimes I am gay, coming out, so, but sometimes even I have difficulties in understanding some of these words. I have to check on vocabularies online to be sure that I do not offend anybody, because as a gay man, I have a privilege because I am a cisgender person. And so I can be part of the oppressing majority rather than a stigmatized identity. And it's incredible. So proliferation of identity. Just take this. I saw this in sexuality, but it's much a prevalent process. Let's go to the next slide. So platforms are part of that because consumers started saying, hey, male, female, you do not represent me. And it takes nothing for consumers, for platforms to recognize these new identities to people. So this is OK Cupid. And you can see questioning, sapiosexual. So there's this category that I think was really created online, but now people identify heteroflexible. So once you were gay or straight or bisexual, but now there's this intermediate identity for people who wouldn't identify as fully bisexual, but occasionally can do something. And it's an identity, you know, people, you can meet people who say it's not something created on social media. You can have people telling you, I am heteroflexible, or any other of these labels. I am a non-binary, I am, you know, you name it. Next. So in some countries, not Italy, but in some countries, Facebook offers, when you create a new account, 71, and it's growing. It's in probably next year, you know, last year they were 60 something, next year will be 90. So you see, two spirits, sometimes it's, you know, two spirit is Native American, it's a different way of conceiving sexuality that was destroyed by colonialism and evangelization and imposing of religion, and now it's coming back through social media, and platforms are an important part into that. Next, when you create a profile, you need to identify yourself, and heteroflexible, be curious, but mostly straight, so mostly straight, or this is a female person, sex positive, a queer woman, interested in only positive sex. I am a heteroflexible / pansexual, polyamorous and king friendly, looking for casual play and friendship with a side of filth or ENM relationship. ENM, I had to Google it because I had no idea what that meant, is ethical non-monogamy. So it's a non-monogamy, so not an exclusive relationship, but it's ethical because everybody, your main partner, if you have one, and everybody else should be informed, but not a unicorn. So unicorn are supposedly, it's another identity, supposedly mythical creatures. So basically in this context, the unicorn is defined as a person, normally a woman, who can date and be in a relation with a married couple, man, woman, even though the concept is fluid and can be adapted to the situation. So again, it's a whole new world, and the social media, consumer culture and social media are at the core of it. Next. So eating, sometimes you wouldn't identify with a specific diet regime. Then, now it's important. And for many years, you were normal, even though I wouldn't like to use the term, so you wouldn't put identity on what you would eat. You would eat whatever, depending on what your culture and so on and so forth. But then you started to have vegetarians, then you started to have vegans, and then you started having a lot of other possible identities that are institutionalized through market-mediated systems. So you can have restaurants and bloggers and cookbook recipes for any of these. And these are offered, they are market niche from one point of view, but also identities. So you could identify as a pescatarian, flexitarian, lacto-ovo-vegetarian, or which is different from vegan, and so on and so forth. And again, these categories, they emerge, some only last a few years and they disappear, some are there to remain, and so on and so forth. Next. So there are today people who identify as shamans, witches, druids, and many others. And the internet first and social media, digital culture in general, are an important part, because you grow up and you think that druids are, you know, Asterix and Obelix, that witches are, you know, Cinderella, all the fairy tales that you read as a kid, and shamans were from some distant culture. You wouldn't believe that this identity was available for you, but there are people who identify as vampires, today. Really, there have been ethnographies conducted on those people. There are people who identify as fairies, not as an insult to gay men, but really the fairies of fairy tales and so on and so forth. And there are so many of these identities. And if you can go next. So people, you know, everybody likes to be different, special, and we are all complex people, you know, our sexuality, our spirituality, our everything, our outlook is so different. And we know that identity is a socialization process. So you are shaped, you acquire the habitus, you blah, 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 you acquire the subcultural skills. And these distributed networked systems that are enabled by social media are part of that. So 10 signs you are a shamanic being. 10 signs you are a witch and don't realize it. So you see, these are memes. So these are things that happens. And then, oh my God, yeah, during the full moon, I feel strange. Oh my God, I have a vivid dreams. Oh my God, my hands are warm. And you give, I'm not being ironic, but it's a general process. Oh my God, yes, I like contact with nature. You give meaning to, and you give an identity, you give a name to some part of that. And this is really, social media have created an important part to play to this. And the people are consumer, try to educate in good faith, good other consumers about how these are the signs that you can look and so on and so forth. Next. So I don't know if you know what or who puppies are. This is a subculture emerging in the broader gay, mostly gay men community, some trans men as well, etc. And it's the idea of identified as a puppy. It started as a BDSM game, but now it's not a practice, it's an identity. And what these young man here says could be said about witches, could be said about a lot of these are the identities. I've always felt something inside me that was different. Everybody feels something inside of themselves, okay? We are humans. So I decided to listen to my inner feelings and I started collecting every info possible about that. So the question on Instagram is, what started you becoming a pup or a puppy and how long ago it happens? So as a kid, I felt different. Then I stumbled upon these possibility for identity, found puppies, I could have found something else. We all have found something else, probably. I'm not a puppy, so I want to say that, but I know people who identify like that. So through consumer culture, through these processes of creating meanings, objects, and doings, you realize that yes, he felt as a puppy, like other people feel they are witches, feel they are whatever, hipsters, and so on and so forth. So through social media, I started not only reading and being exposed to this possible identity, started meeting other people, and everything started. Next. Now in Milan, there's a collective of people visible, and they are detaching it from just a minority sexual practice into becoming a full-fledged identity. Okay, so they claim a public space. It's not something that happens only virtual. And this is the next step. So digitally enabled interaction possibility and so on and so forth have consequences in the real world. And again, you might say, where's consumer culture? You can really see social media about that, but where's the social culture? Next. No, I will go back to that later on, but you need masks, for example. So there's a consumer culture part. So I said that some of these identities are really the result of identity politics, the visibility of previously invisible and oppressed identities. Some are native in consumer culture, but I want to add now that the market is a site where, and the big brands sometimes, where you try to have your identity recognized, however it was created, and where you try to meet other people, and where you try also to reform the market and society to your advantage. Okay, can be as simple as you, if you are a trans person, to ask Facebook. The state is difficult to ask the state to recognize your identity. The market sometimes is easier. So consumers as activists sometimes do not just try to reform the state or society in general, they try to reform the market, to change the practices of some brands or platforms or retailers or so on and so forth. And through social media, they have the power to do so because they can, it's unprecedented, they can target big corporation and ultimately they can affect them. Things, what happened? I mean, we have this Nike with the Black Lives Matter example that we are going to explore this week. It's incredible, unprecedented. The people wouldn't be able to do that in the past. Next. So, doppelganger brand image, you know, you start targeting, this is not necessarily linked to identity processes, but you have the power to start a boycott, a consumer boycott to big brands. You start tampering with the image of brands that have wasted a million of euros in digital marketing and advertising, etc., to create a beautiful image. And then you highlight the contradiction. It's about consumption. It's a super expensive coffee. It's not really fair. Come on, how do you believe you are stupid? It's all about the money. It's, you know, super sugary products that cannot be good for the health or anybody consuming them. And again, you highlight the contradiction. And this is not necessarily about identity formation process, but it's to show the kind of power that consumers have today thanks to social media. Next, you can really target a specific corporation that you considered unethical. Next, and you can even fight for greater inclusion of the market. There was a very interesting paper by Aline Fisher and Diane Scaraboto about plus size consumers and how blogs, the first generation of blogs, and now you will say social media, have been instrumental of creating, not only of assembling together the plus size or the fat acceptance movement, but only on creating, of providing opportunity to plus size fashion bloggers to create this shared identity and to start pressuring big brands to increase the sizes of their offer, because they were complaining that plus size fashion was impossible to find and it was ugly. So if we are a middle upper class consumer and have money, why can't we buy Gucci? And again, pressuring the market within the frame of an identity politics and social justice framework. Next, can be other identities. So now with Black Lives Matter, you know, you're pressuring Chanel to have a makeup of different shades adapted to different skin tones and complexion, the same for shampoo. And again, the process is that sometimes you have celebrity, you have influencers, people who are normal consumers, representative of these new identities or previously invisible and neglected identities who emerge, attract audiences, publics if you want, but then are able to change the conversation, the marketing conversation, because they can launch their own subcultural products as a subcultural entrepreneurs, or they can give ideas or pressure big brands to do the same. And there's some cooptation processes very often involved. So again, it's a mix between branding, social media, and identity politics. Let's go to the next slide. So new identities, this is the process, how we can put together this process of identity proliferation with marketing, consumer culture, and identity politics. These new identities become market segments, sometimes a market niche. Niche is a very small segment. Because the mainstream market, like society, neglect some groups of people, even the market neglect them. So these create a space for people to become subcultural entrepreneurs, because they need to create products that are not available. They need to learn the subcultural skills that go with that, and then they can sell the skills, they can train other people, they can sell the products that they created. And sometimes they monetize about that. Sometimes they do that for ideal reasons, to create common ideas. And when the market is large enough, the big brands co-opt it, providing a further identity to the visibility to these new identities, and sometimes diluting them. And I'll go next. Again, if you want to be a puppy, you need the puppy masks. And at the very beginning, you would have puppies who were handy, who created their own masks. But now on Amazon, it's made in China. It's a mass market merchandise. You can have the haute couture and you can have the mass market version of that. Next, if you are a witch, you need magical objects. You need one or many tarot deck. You need to learn how to read the tarot. You need candles, incense, magic wands. Next. And, okay, so there was another slide, but maybe I think I'll stop now. I will not have time to talk about witches, but again, this process of linking social media. No, go back, please. I think that I will complete now. Alessandro, just skip the witches part and go to the final slide. So the witches case is very interesting because I am, you know, I've done ethnographic work in this field for many, many, many years. I have some work which is under review in this moment, and I've really looked at how different generations of social media and different approaches of consumer culture have really shaped expanding the identity value of the witch identity, and how the affordances of a specific social media platform has been instrumental into that, because the witches of internet and news group of the old generation mostly migrated to Facebook when Facebook was available, and they're still there. But there was a new generation of witches on Instagram, which were on Facebook. People debated and they fight, and there was a further fragmentation going on. Instagram is all about aesthetics, because the key idea to have followers is that you have to do wonderful images and magical objects. They do not need to be effective to perform magic ritual, but need to look good on Instagram. And with TikTok, you have videos, 1 minute videos and less, and you have baby witches that are, it's the new identity, the baby witches of TikTok, and it's a lot of fun. So hashtag witches of Instagram, hashtag witch talk, you go there, you find it's so incredibly inspiring to study. So to conclude, postmodern identities and social relationships are co-creating through consumption and marketplace generated resources. I think that now I already said that before, but now you understand hopefully a little better what I meant with these. Social media have accelerated this process of identity fragmentation, specialization, proliferation that increasingly weaves together identity value, consumption, consumer culture, marketing. Digital methods offer unprecedented opportunities for mapping this process beyond the usual consumer interviews and ethnographic method. In my study on online witches, I did as I could, like interviewing people, like reading every possible blog, like examining and qualitative analyzing in a very unstructured manner, TikTok, Facebook groups, and etc. But it's so huge that I'm hopeless to provide a fair representation. And witches of Instagram, I think that by now should be more than 5 million posts. Witch Talk is even more, the number of posts on which hashtag Witch Talk is more than that. And I am desperate to find the ways to really analyze all these data, because I'm increasingly dissatisfied with analyzing, interviewing 20 consumers, and that would be it. I think that by analyzing the 20 consumers, I can interpret and analyze the data much better, because some of these scraping of data and visualization without qualitative insight are sort of meaningless, so very difficult to analyze. But this is why I'm very excited about this week that we are sharing together. And I want to learn more how, you know, to bring these methods to help me for my next generation of studies. So it was a lot. Thank you very much to listen to me. Maybe we have a little time for questions, and I will hang out with you this whole week, so you'll have time to ask me questions if you're curious, or anyway, yeah. We'll be working together.
Definitely. Thank you very much, Diego, for this very inspiring, very interesting presentation. It was super cool, because also you were able to keep together, very nice introduction of consumer culture, which is important to introduce. I'm sure not all of us, all of our participants are necessarily familiar with this concept. So it's nice to have a clear and nice introduction. But also the last part was very, very interesting. And to my point of view, it opens up a lot of possible paths of combining traditional consumer culture research and identity and digital methods. I actually have a couple of questions, more questions, but since we don't have that much time, because we have to close because we have a lunch break and then we're coming at 2, maybe it's better if someone from the student has a question, it's better that they ask better than me. It's better to leave floor to them, because this is their place. I don't know, guys, if you agree, if you have some questions.
Maybe if I may.
Dominic, okay, please.
Yeah. Well, I don't really have a question, but it's more a sort of comment, yeah. if you want. So of course, the professor spoke about a lot of different topics. I will just focus on the part about the religions, since that's mostly my field. So I'm a bit more familiar on that. And of course, there was this huge talk about being spiritual but not non-religious, on religiosity beyond affiliation, right? And this is a huge part of what non-religion studies are doing today. But then there is also this idea of sacralization, for example, of consumption. And that's something slightly different from my perspective. And it's becoming more and more common to see this kind of concept stretching, right? When religion is kind of applied as a conceptual category to a lot of different things. And I'm wondering to which extent it is still religion. Of course, we are still talking about beliefs, And it can be applied pretty much everywhere. I mean, I a year ago, I published a short article in FBK magazine when I was provocatively showing some faith-based elements in algorithmic decision-making. But the point is, aren't we just, you know, running the risk to enter a dangerous conceptual loophole where suddenly everything becomes a form of religion? So that's, let's say, a reflection on the matter.
So, very interesting. What do you think, Diego?
Quick answer, and we can talk later. And I'd love to read this piece you were mentioning about. But let me say that I don't know if you're familiar with this old paper, like Sacred and Profane in Consumer Process in Sacred and Profane and Consumer Behavior, I don't know, Belk, Wallendorf and Sherry, like at the core of consumer culture theory. They say that there are these two processes playing on the sacralization of consumption, which you just mentioned, but also the other way, the, let me call it the marketization of religion. And that was already happening before, you know, these social media enabled consumer culture intermix that I've been thinking out. So to me, it's less of a theoretical question and it's more of an empirical question. To me, people are doing stuff that are not necessarily reflected in our theories. So I will start from asking what people do and observing what people do because it's interesting. And it's true that, you know, I do not, you know, when I say that people are, say they are spiritual but not religious, I'm not, I take this at the emic value. So I agree with you that sometimes imposing a category on these things can be its religion, can be its sacred sacralization, etc. It's quite arbitrary from the point of view of researchers. So I think that you can have people who say that people in the stadium, you know, it's the new religion for people who are atheists, etc. You can say that, and some people have said that, and you can disagree theoretically. And I wouldn't particularly like to impose that category because I don't like that. In consumer research, for example, in CCT, everything was sacred. And then, you know, for 20 years, I was so annoyed reading papers were saying that whatever, you know, brand relationship are sacred, this is sacred. And then it's a word that doesn't mean it's a put because the reviewer will read it and will be pleased, but then you do not engage with the process. So I think that as scholars, we sometimes can do better theorization, but I would put, you know, for me in this ethic, emic debate, we should really mapping the what's happening in the field because of what people do. It's not call them consumers, but what people do is so much more advanced than many of our theories. And then a theory is just writing a paper. And let me be very pragmatic, you know, some people can write a paper claiming that going to the stadium is the new religion that has substituted the Sunday mass, and it's okay. I mean, and you can disagree, write another excellent paper about that, but sometimes this self-referential academic discussion for me are not so interesting unless they are linked to some kind of a public policy that can be dangerous. So I would be more concerned about, you know, wearing a veil in public and what people make of that. That can be much more dangerous than calling going to the stadium of religion. But I don't know if I answered, but we can keep having this conversation later on.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. An Thank entire you. Week. In the meanwhile, a compliment came for you, Diego. I don't know if you were able to read it in the comments. Thank you, Diego, from Hossein, right? Thank you, Diego, for a fascinating presentation. I have always been used to theorize an abstract concept of CCT, but you made CCT sound very interesting, of course, super fun and uber cool with a lot of practical application. That's right. Also, you provided some good motivation for applying digital methods in CCT research, which still needs quite convincing to publication outlets, as most journals in our field are not still very encouraging in terms of article with digital methods. Thank you so much, Hossein. We other question from the floor?
Amy raised her.
I had my hand raised. Oh Lord. Very interesting this keynote speech. I'm only married to a finance professor, so I'm coming from half knowledge of behavioral finance. But I was wondering with the marketing and the CCT, is the other element, the behavioral economics and the nudge principle of the irrationality within economical behavior and then the nudge principle, is that the other element of affecting consumer behavior? Of behaviors are co-creators, but yet you also have the industry trying to influence that behavior.
Absolutely. I mean, marketing is about influencing consumer. So one of my original slides, when I say that the consumer ecology and the consumer and consumer culture, I sort of conflated consumer psychology with this behavioral perspective that are one of the areas. You know, there are some people, it's a small tribes, because most in, you know, they are more similar to consumer psychologists than consumer culture theory, but there are behavioral people applying, you know, everything that you know about finance to study consumers. The point is that, you know, methods and theories, there's an interplay. So sometimes when talking, you know, so for example, when I talk about religion or spirituality or, you know, witchcraft, you can imagine. So very often people who are from this other side, they have a different categories like superstition. Superstition is, there's a lot of value judgment into that, like irrational. There's a lot of value judgment into that, and they apply this frame of reference to study, which also impacts the research question that are referenced. And when you do interpretive critical research, sometimes you reflect a lot on how to treat your informant fairly and not superimposing theoretical notion, constructs, variables that are sort of disrespectful. So I once had this interesting conversation, but you know, it's a sort of a paradigmatic divide. To me, it's very difficult to talk with somebody who considers that a superstition, and then the consumer superstition scale to measure it, and so on and so forth. And if I had a paper like that sent to my informants for, which is something that I sometimes do to be sure I understood everything, and they like the way they're represented, they will, you know, they will say, come on, dude, why do you do that? They would feel that I betrayed the trust. So I think that I cannot really work with notions that are like irrationality or superstition and so on and so forth. However, from a practical point of view, if I want to use, if I am in a marketing or in a social nonprofit organization, and I can use those methodological theoretical instruments to affect behavior, like wearing a mask or whatever, you know, that is totally fine. And it's a very, very useful. It's a different paradigmatic way of operating, and you will not find much of that in consumer culture.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, if we have not, just to continue, maybe I do the very last question. So, and then we can have a nice break, a lunch break, and we convene at 2 p.m. Again, it's not a question, it's more of a comment that just popped up in my mind. I hope to be clear. Diego, I found very, very interesting, I mean, the last part of your presentation in which you describe this proliferation of identity. And it came to my mind that there's an interesting phenomenon. I mean, I don't know if you agree. It seems to me that also this proliferation of identity is sometimes driven by a platform, which have this necessity to put a label on people, to categorize people. Because I mean, if you are able to categorize people, it's easier to track them, to sell them advertising and so on and so forth, all this stuff of the platform. So interesting to me, because I mean, my idea when I started studying this 10 years ago, also when I was a student in the early 2000s, it seems to me that consumers started to escape the label. So also now, I mean, people don't like to have a label put on, and they want to define in a way that reflect themselves, or they don't like labels, okay, just put in this way. But now we have this return of this label process because of the platform. I mean, you show us that beautiful slide in all the with all the different categories, sexual identities categories, and that is not the case was brought about Cupid. I mean, so this is my comment. I don't know if you agree. I mean, I'm sure that people need some labels that reflects better who they are, but from the other end, I see, I mean, this tendency of platforms to standardize. I mean,
I can say it's a sort of a chicken and egg.
Yeah.
Because it's very true that platforms want to categorize, to identify market segments, blah, blah, blah. And this is a mix of market research with platform strategy and monetization through advertising. But the very processes that lead people to escape labels end up creating new labels. So non-binary.
Yeah.
You try to escape from a male versus a female, and then you end up creating a proliferation of new labels to deal with that, non-binary being one, etc. And I will say that I don't know if, again, chicken and egg, I don't know if the main reason for Facebook to offer these 70 whatever opportunities for identification is to sell the data, you know, to create consumer profiles, to send the data to their advertiser, or it was a consumer themselves wanted to be recognized, to have their identity recognized. And some of these labels are so minimal, they would be like 0.00001% of the American or UK, etc. But still, they do not want to offend the people who lack their things. And I think that it's really a game of mirror, because I read somewhere, not all, it's true, if to define these categories, now you go on Twitter and look at the way people define themselves. So it's in the next generation. You do not even have to pressure a company to be included. You produce data that the company about identities that the companies, fearing to offend the people, use it so that they will be sure that there is your box to click and you will not start a boycott out of that. So I think that it's two processes. I mean, one doesn't negate the other. And eventually, you know, sometimes it's to avoid the PR problems. Sometimes eventually, immediately after, you want to, somebody in the company try to make money out of that, and they feed on each other.
Okay, clear. Yeah, totally see your point. Thank you. Thank you, Diego. I also we will be able to discuss again this matter, because it's super fascinating. Maybe hopefully put into practice. I mean, we don't have a specific project in this summer school about proliferation of identity, but could be for sure a topic for something else, for the next summer school next year. I mean, I'm very, very happy so far. So if you agree, we can stop here and reconvene at 2 p.m. Unless, I mean, you have any question, any kind of question. Also beyond.
There was a raise then from Narek. Maybe if that's a very quick intervention, we can allow.
No problem.
Comment or ask a question.
Yeah. Thank you. Hello, everyone. Thank you, Diego, for your presentation. I also have a question about identities. I was wondering about the authenticity of identity projects within the context of markets and capitalism. So consumers generally tend to identify with entities like brands, others, etc. So in a way that creates some isomorphic pressures and homogenizing tendencies, right? So from the one hand, each of us wants to be distinct and different, but at the same time, we look the same. Like for instance, the hipster identity category is quite recognizable, right? They have a similar taste, all of them, style, I mean. So this challenges the notion of emancipation provided by markets or consumer culture. So I was just wondering, like, how emancipated can someone be since they base their identity on a certain set of predefined elements, like brands produced by and reproduced by capitalism? Like, how is consumer agency defined in this kind of discussions?
So thank you very much for this question, because I think that you nail it. You know, I mean, it's why sometimes marketing is so ridiculous. Because you try to convince consumers that by buying mass-produced commodities that are charged through advertising, marketing, branding, whatever, with the symbolic meanings, they will be able to express a unique identity, even though those same commodities infused with the same cultural meanings are bought by a lot of other consumers. You know, think of luxury. I mean, it's haute couture that nobody buys because it doesn't break even, it's so many people, but then you buy an accessory, not even prêt-à-porter, an accessory, and you partake into that symbolic meaning through which you express and build your unique identity. And I think that it's, you know, back to sociological understanding, you know, being unique, being different, and being the same as everybody else, I think it's the... you know, it's two opposing tendency, but they are very importantly reflected inside ourselves. You know, sociologists of fashion have really looked at that, you know, being different about belonging. I think that it's this paradox of the human being that brands are very, very able to make money on, and marketing is all about that to some extent. So I think, you know, and again, to be fair towards consumers, if you really interview them, many of them put their heart, you know, they really highlight in interviews their role, you know, they, you know, every consumer I interview stresses in my, you know, across projects, they stress how unique they are. And I think that the market gives them resources to contribute to these fiction of how unique we are. It's a nice fairy tale which we like to believe. I don't know if it's emancipating, but I have to say that if I empathically listen to people, to consumers, they are authentic because they are able. So for me, it's the miracle of marketing and consumer culture that despite being commodities mass produced with the standard cultural meaning transferred to them, people, and I think it's the magic of their co-creation role, are able to make it their own and to link to their complex fragmented identity projects so that eventually it's authentic. You know, you really, maybe they say that the others are not authentic, they context other way of consumers doing the same, but I think that this is really not postmodern because it's a grand narrative, that of identity, and there's no way about that. Only very critical consumers are able to go beyond the surface of marketing. And you find a lot of them, like the marketing, when I call it the big brands marketing, like the Dior, the Ferrari, the McDonald's, you know, very critical consumers are able to go beyond the surface, and they claim their authenticity by not consuming this kind of products or by not putting their identity, even if they do drink Starbucks, but it's not part of who I am. It's only something I do because I have no other alternatives today. Maybe I make fun of those stupid victims of brands, of fashion, of materialistic society. But then if you dig a little bit, they just align themselves to other ways of creating their identities. And so maybe they can be successful in detaching their identity from, let me call it the big brand, but then they have this smaller brand, these maybe alternative non-capitalistic exchange circuits, but we cannot escape the market. And this is the empirical question of looking at consumer and how they claim authenticity and they claim a unique identity despite everything that we know about. There's these interesting papers on, you know, Soren Askegaard. It's in my, you know, at the end of my PowerPoint, I put some reference lead on the context of context. Is that unfortunately, many people are not aware, like we as scholars are, particularly sociologists, sociologically inclined scholars, of how these context structures affect behavior. And again, it's everybody wants to be protagonist of their life. Everyone's want to be authentic. And it's, but thank you for making the points. You really nailed it.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you, Narek. The very last thing, I mean, Diego, are you okay if I share your slides with you?
Yeah. I think I already shared with everybody, so please.
Cool. Very soon I will share also my slides with all the material and references you saw. I'm very happy so far, but by the way, we still have 10 minutes again, so if there are some additional questions, please be free to make them, otherwise I can call it a day. Are we cool? Okay, thank you so much, guys. Thank you again to Diego, a virtual applause. And let's see, 2 p.m., okay? Same link.
Ciao, bye-bye.
Ciao. So let's stop the recording.
Professore, tutto ok con la registrazione?
Allora, adesso credo che sia scritto recording, ok?
Sì, dà ancora registrazione in corso.
Perché io a un certo punto ho avuto un calo della connessione, si è sconnesso internet e mi sono riconnesso. Non vedo qui come fermarlo, perché nel mio Zoom c'è un segnale di stop. Qui invece non c'è nulla.
Allora, in realtà posso stopparlo pure io.
Ok, lo fallo tu. Dammi pure del tu, ti prego. Non...
Ok, scusa.
Povero vecchio. No. Siamo appunto colleghi, oltre che non è questione di età, è una questione di essere colleghi. Quindi vabbè, io l'ho capito come farlo fare partire il record.
Sì.
Perché, vabbè, semplicemente lo Zoom che ho a Pavia è leggermente diverso,